Welcome to online worship here at Pinnacle Presbyterian Church. It's good that you're with us today. I'm Wes Abram, the pastor here at Pinnacle, and I and our other pastors join with all of our staff in welcoming you to this service. You see behind me our sanctuary, looking lonely during these weeks of physical separation. But while our pews may be empty, our hearts are full of the Holy Spirit, full of gratitude, full of anticipation of the Sunday when these pews will be filled again. So let's keep our connection strong until then. And so being full and connected in all these ways, we begin our worship. By the rivers of Babylon, we wept when we remembered Zion. There on the willow trees, we hung our harps. There our captives asked us to joyfully sing, saying, "Sing us one of the songs of Zion." But how can we sing the Lord's song in a foreign land? O Jerusalem, may my right hand wither if I forget you. May I never sing again if I do not remember you, for the city of God is my highest joy. Lift your heads, lift your spirits and your hearts as we sing our praise.
Praise be the Lord, O Lord.
Welcome to online worship at Pinnacle Presbyterian Church. Let me continue to thank all those who are working so hard to keep our worship, education, care, and outreach ministries strong during these days. We're learning new things every week and appreciate your kind words as we do. We also appreciate your participation in all that's underway, from weekly online Bible studies to committee meetings and video creations, to mission projects, and most especially in prayer. As one example of an effort that is directly tied to the opportunities of this time, just this week, folks connected to our deacons board and our homelessness ministries delivered over 300 homemade face masks to UMOM, the shelter for homeless families in Phoenix. Food collected for Vista del Camino in our emergency food drive last week has been delivered this week after a few days of storage to be sure the containers are virus-free. We will have a similar drive on April 25th and 26th. Watch our website for details. I invite you to keep a close eye on your inbox on Wednesdays for our weekly e-newsletters and on our website, on which there is a regularly updated page with information about our ministries. Later in this service, following our video recorded children's message, we will have a ministry moment shared by our Presbyterian young adult volunteer, Andrew Avram, who has recently been recalled from Peru by our National YAV program, along with all international volunteers. He's currently under quarantine, just having arrived from overseas, so is sharing with us today by video. And finally, this morning, special thanks to our Director of Ministries in Music and Arts, David Allen, for preaching this morning. We traditionally do a special service, a little more relaxed and with special musical offerings on this Sunday after Easter. We call it the Sunday After. This year, David has agreed to bring us the message as he had planned, and we have shifted the music a little bit, but continue with a relaxed feel to our worship today. And so David has kept the promise of sharing the word, and we thank him. With all of this in mind, let us continue our worship.
The proof of God's amazing love is this, that while we were sinners, Christ died for us. Trusting in God's love and grace, let us confess our sin together. Lord, open unto us light for our darkness, courage for our fear, hope for our despair, peace for our turmoil, joy for our sorrow, strength for our weakness, wisdom for our confusion, forgiveness for our sin, and love for our hates. Lord, Lord, open unto us. And now hear our silent prayers of confession. God's love has been poured into our hearts through the gift of the Holy Spirit. Brothers and sisters, believe the good news. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Let us rise in spirit and sing our praise.
Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, all thy works shall praise thy name in earth and sky and sea. Holy, 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 merciful and mighty, God in three persons, blessed Trinity.
Because we are reconciled to God, we are reconciled one to another. Let us share the peace of God with each other. The peace of our Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Good morning, Pinnacle, and happy Sunday after Easter. He is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia. Today our message is from the book of Job, and it's about a man named Job who had everything. He had lots of animals, he had lots of children, he had a beautiful home, beautiful land, and he believed in God. He did everything seemingly right, and then he lost nearly everything. And was it because of something he did, or was it his fault? It was not. I don't know about you, but we have lost things in our lives. I want to introduce you to my little dogs. One of them is inside. She's a little shy. But this is Ozzy, and his partner's name is Harriet. And Ozzy and Harriet, and then this is Moberly and Molly. They're all rescues. But Ozzy and Harriet came together as a rescue, and they had a little baby named Snowflake. And we adopted all three of them at the same time. And little Snowflake is not with us today. And it wasn't because it was anything of our fault. It was because she just wasn't healthy. She wasn't able to stay on earth with us as long as we wanted her to. But you know what? Just like Job, we believe in God, and we share his love with everything that we do. And I want you to remember, as you listen to David today tell a story about Job, the true takeaway is that it's so important to just share God's love, even if there is something that's taken away from us. I love you. I can't wait to see you all very soon. Have a wonderful Sunday.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Andrew Abram. As some of you know, I've spent the last 8 months as a member of the Young Adult Volunteer Program in Wanago, Peru. The program places its members in areas all throughout the world, and each of us work to help better the community in which we were called to serve. In Wanago, I met some of the most fantastic people I ever have in my life. Sadly, my service was cut short when the program canceled all of its operations due to the coronavirus outbreak. After being stranded in Peru for 3 weeks due to Peru's strict anti-coronavirus measures, I was finally able to leave the country and return home to Scottsdale through an embassy-based flight early last week. I want to share everything I can with you, all about my experience in detail, including descriptions of my work, the culture in Wanago, and the many lessons learned. If you want to learn more, please go to my blog at andrewabram.home.blog. On the site, I posted monthly updates in real time, descriptions and reflections about my work. I will soon be posting closing reflections, as well as some promotional content about Granja Lendero Ecológica, the sustainable farm where I worked, which continually needs our support. Thank you to all who, through your efforts and attention, helped make this experience possible. I can't wait to be able to thank you all in person.
Let us pray together. God of all nations, your Spirit hovers over us and all our troubled world, interceding for us with sighs too deep for words. Stay with us as we wait for news, for healing, for help. Give us strength and courage to bear the unknown. Open our eyes to the movements of your Spirit. Uphold us with your sustaining grace and show us your care through neighbors, strangers, and friends. Sustain all those whom we love with your healing and your peace. Guide hands and strengthen hearts. We pray this day for all those impacted by this world pandemic, all around the world, young and old. But especially we pray for those in vulnerable groups this day, the elderly, those whose health is already compromised, the homeless, those living in crowded conditions, the uninsured, those who live in countries or cities with poor health care or indifferent governments. And especially we pray for those whose lives are upended temporarily, parents with children home now from school, persons alone in their homes, workers and professionals sorting work out and more. And especially we pray for those whose lives may be upended more permanently. Business owners trying to hold things together and preserve jobs. Those suddenly unemployed. Those who have lost loved ones. And especially we pray for those on the front lines of help. for doctors, nurses, and others in healthcare, scientists seeking treatment and cure, teachers working online, leaders making decisions. And here in this community of faith, we pray for our partner ministries, for staff as well as those they serve, for all those who they seek to support, volunteers who can't help as easily as they once could, for homeless families at UMOM, for hungry folk at Andre House, the students and staff at Create Academy as they seek to conclude their year and their work, all the congregations of our Presbytery, and most especially Native American congregations, Haitians served by Harmony Ministries, Pastor Luke and his family, and all leaders of that ministry, Palestinians served by the Lutheran Ministries in Bethlehem, Dr. Raheb and his family, and all leaders in that ministry, for Peruvians served at the Lindero Ecological Farm and other church-related ministries. You are the God of all people. We pray this day that you show us how to love all people, that unity in your spirit may overcome isolation, unity in purpose overcome separation, and unity in love overcome fear. These things we pray in your spirit, with the words that you taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. We take a morning offering even as we worship in this way, because in worship we give ourselves as an offering to God, however we give that in time, in energy, in talent, in prayer, and in financial resources to the ministry. So as we take our offering this morning, we invite you to pray about all the ways in which you might give. And as you give financially, you may give online at pinnaclepres.org or text pinnaclepres to 77977 or online, as we said, or in other ways through the church office. We give of ourselves on this day. O God, take these gifts, speed them to your service, and in all the ways that we find to help these days, quicken us, enable us, empower us to be your people. Amen.
Will you pray with me? Guide us, O God, by your word and Holy Spirit, that in your light we may see light, in your truth find freedom, and in your will discover peace. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Our lesson comes to us from the book of Job, the first chapter, verses 1 through 22. Now hear these words. In the land of Uz lived a man whose name was Job. This man was blameless and upright. He feared God and shunned evil. He had 7 sons and 3 daughters. He owned 7,000 sheep, 3,000 camels, 500 yoke of oxen, and 500 donkeys, and had a large number of servants. He was the greatest man among all the people of the East. His sons used to take turns holding feasts in their homes, and they would invite their 3 daughters to eat and drink with them. When a period of feasting had run its course, Job would send and have them purified. Early in the morning, he would sacrifice a burnt offering for each of them, thinking, "Perhaps my children have sinned and cursed God in their hearts." This was Job's regular custom. One day, the angels came to present themselves before the Lord, and Satan also came with them. The Lord said to Satan, "Where have you come from?" Satan answered the Lord, "From roaming through the earth and going back and forth in it." Then the Lord said to Satan, "Have you considered my servant Job? There is no one on earth like him. He is blameless and upright, a man who fears God and shuns evil." "Does Job fear God for nothing?" Satan replied. "Have you not put a hedge around him and his household and everything he has? You have blessed the work of his hands so that his flocks and herds are spread throughout the land. But stretch out your hand and strike everything he has, and he will surely curse you to your face." The Lord said to Satan, "Very well then, everything he has is in your hands, but on the man himself do not lay a finger." Then Satan went out from the presence of the Lord. One day when Job's sons and daughters were feasting and drinking wine at the oldest brother's house, a messenger came to Job and said, "The oxen were plowing and the donkeys were grazing nearby, and the Sabines attacked and carried them off. They put the servants to the sword, and I am the only one who has escaped to tell." While he was still speaking, another messenger came and said, "The fire of God fell from the sky and burned up the sheep and the servants, and I am the only one left who escaped to tell." While he was still speaking, another messenger came and said, "The Chaldeans had formed 3 raiding parties and swept down on the camels and carried them off. They put the servants to the sword, and I am the only one who escaped to tell." While he was still speaking, yet another messenger came and said, "Your sons and daughters were feasting and drinking wine at the oldest brother's house, when suddenly a mighty wind swept in from the desert and struck the 4 corners of the house. It collapsed on them, and they are dead. And I am the only one who has escaped to tell." At this, Job got up and tore his robe and shaved his head. Then he fell to the ground in worship and said, "Naked I came from my mother's womb, and naked I will depart. The Lord gave, and the Lord has taken away. May the name of the Lord be praised." In all this, Job did not sin by charging God with wrongdoing. The word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. what we really love and trust aren't truly known until we are tested by loss. This is essentially the point that Satan made when talking to God about Job. And that odd scene in the first chapter of Job, when Satan presented himself before God, God said to him, "Have you considered my servant Job? That there is none like him on the earth, a blameless and upright man, one who fears God and turns away from evil." Satan's sly response was, "Does Job trust God for no reason? Have you not put a hedge around him and his house and all that he has? You have blessed the work of his hands, and his possessions have increased in the land. But stretch out your hand and touch all that he has, and he will surely curse you to your face." In less formal terms, Satan is saying, "Of course Job trusts you. You've given him everything that he should ever want. But if you take it away, he will curse you." Note the irony here. In this manipulative moment, Satan inadvertently pointed out the core error of prosperity theology. Prosperity obscures rather than reveals how much men truly love God. Blessings easily turning into curses as sinners subtly or not so subtly come to love and trust the blessings more than the blesser. Satan knew this by experience. He was so confident that Job would curse God if the blessings were removed from him. He had seen this thousands and thousands of times before. Satan knew that the taking away more than the giving would reveal the truth that Job trusted those things. But so did God. God knew Job's heart. God gave Satan permission to take away Job's children, his wealth, his health, and his reputation. And the result? Then Job arose and tore his robe and shaved his head and fell on the ground and worshiped. And he said, "Naked I came from my mother's womb, and naked shall I return. The Lord gave, and the Lord has taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord." Satan was proven wrong about Job. But Satan wasn't proven wrong about concealing power of prosperity and the revealing power of loss. Even the world sometimes catches glimpses of this principle. As the song goes, "Well, you only need the light when it's burning low. You only miss the sun when it starts to snow. Only know you love her when you let her go. Only know you've been high when you're feeling low. Only hate the road when you're missing home. Only know you love her when you let her go." Satan gets no pleasure out of humans enjoying real pleasure. He would prefer to kill and maim and steal and destroy if doing so doesn't push someone towards the faith in God. But he also knows that a consistently effective tool to weaken and impede and disease the church is to let her prosper. Prosperity has a greater tendency to conceal idolatry and false faith. So, just as he tried with Jesus, Satan sometimes will offer us the world. He would rather us be faithlessly prosperous than afflicted and faithful. But Jesus wants to embrace the true prosperity gospel. He wants to have real treasures in heaven, the gift of pleasures forevermore. So when Jesus calls us, he often asks us to leave homes, to leave lands, our family, our vocation for his sake and for the sake of the gospels. It's why he requires us to deny ourselves and take up our crosses. Because, like Paul described, when for Christ's sake we are willing to abandon those things that the world considers the only gain worth having, it shows that Christ is truly gain to us. It is also why, as God's disciples, He conforms us to the image of his Son. He will, like Job, take away earthly things that are precious to us, the affections of our hearts, both sinful and righteous, that were more concealed in the having, are more revealed in the losing. Yes, our testing is more than just for us. We must remember, like Job experiences, that there is often more going on in our experience than meets our eye. Job didn't know when the calamities hit that God was putting Satan to shame. Peter and the disciples wouldn't have known Satan's involvement in their temptations during the Passion Week had Jesus not told them. Likewise, we often aren't aware of the full cosmic struggle in which we are involved. But these texts and others remind us that the struggle is occurring, and we should be careful to jump into conclusions based on our own perceptions alone. So what does this have to do with our current situation, you ask? Well, for starters, we have lost much in the past few weeks. The treadmill that we've all been on the past decade simply stopped. It is, in a word, profound. Not the deaths, not the virus, but the great pause that we find ourselves in. The curtain is wide open, and I encourage you to not recoil from the bright light, even if it's hurting your eyes. What has been taken away has afforded us a once-in-a-lifetime chance to see ourselves in the plainest of views. It has been over 100 years since we've had the chance to see what would happen if we all simply stopped. Even our planet is rattling less. Coyotes have been seen on the Golden Gate Bridge. Birds are chirping in the middle of Madison Avenue. And the canals of Venice are suddenly clear. This takeaway has brought to light all the beautiful and painful truths of how we live. Oh, the world will tell us when it's time to return to normal. We will know that because there will be ads and billboards that will bombard our every waking minute, telling us that it's okay to return to the pace we once were living. Coca-Cola will make us happy, and Mercedes will make us successful, and promotions will satisfy us, even if it means less time with the ones we love the most. I encourage you to really think about what you want to put back into your life once we return to normal. This is our chance to define a new version of normal. This is rare and, dare I say, sacred. The crucial thing for us to remember is that all that God does for us as his children is for our good. He is blessed in both the giving and the taking away, because both are for the sake of our joy. Catherine O'Meara has been called the poet laureate of our current situation, and on her recent blog she writes, "And they read books and listened and rested and exercised and made art and played games and learned new ways of being and were still. And they listened more deeply. Some meditated, some prayed, some danced, some met their shadows. And the people began to think differently. And the people healed. And in the absence of people living in ignorant, dangerous, mindless, and heartless ways, the earth began to heal as well. And when the danger passed and the people joined together again, they grieved their losses and made new choices and dreamed new images and created new ways to live and heal the earth fully as they had been healed." Often it is in the taking away that our true love and trust are revealed, which is a great mercy to us and usually for others. And often in this age, the most valuable, most satisfying, most beneficial, longest-lasting gifts we receive and pass along to others end up coming through the experiences of our losses. Perhaps, my friends, that is the true takeaway. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Seed on the land.
Friends, hear this charge. Rest in the full knowledge that our hope is not in who governs us or what laws are passed or what great things we do as a nation. Our hope is not in the gain or the loss. Our hope is in the power of Jesus Christ working in and through the hearts of his people today and forever. Amen.
It's good that you've joined us in worship today. This is a reality that we'll never be comfortable with, but we still hope that we can live into this time with creativity, faith, and connection. Guidance is still unclear from the government about when and how we'll be able to be together again in this space. But we know that it will be weeks, maybe months, before these pews are filled and these walls vibrate with your singing. We still hope that you feel the Spirit, even on screen. I want to thank you for so many emails and letters and other expressions of gratitude, support, care, and encouragement that you've been sending all of our staff and to myself during these past few weeks. You've also been sending offers to help. That's a beautiful testimony to the strength of this congregation. Thank you. You know that some of our other programs of the church continue online. Some new opportunities are being made available and new ways of connection are being tried. Please be patient. Your ideas are very welcome, even if we can't do all of them. Do be sure to make sure that your computer system and internet connection are as up to date as you can make them and that you have a camera that you can use to participate in events and meetings at the church. Most of our events and meetings are using a program called Zoom, which you can download onto your computer. Some leaders of programs prefer different programs like GoToMeeting or Skype or FaceTime or Google Hangouts or others. They'll let you know and help you sort that out if you need help. But call the church office and we'll be as helpful as we can to be sure that you can participate. And please let us know about particular prayer requests that you might have for your health, for your employment, for your families, for your concerns for the world. Prayer remains at the center of who we are and what we do. And if you've never made the leap of joining this community of faith called Pinnacle Presbyterian Church, even in this time, we want to encourage you to prayerfully consider joining us. Our staff member, Kelly McGinn, is available to you by phone or email to discuss membership. Check her out at the church office. And let me also encourage you to reach out to any one of our pastors or program staff if you'd like to know more about life in Christ. We need him, every one of us. God bless you all. See you next time.